Je voudrais du soleil vert, des dentelles et des théières, des photos de bord de mer, dans mon jardin d'hiver. Je voudrais de la lumière, comme en Nouvelle-Angleterre. Je veux changer d'atmosphère, dans mon jardin d'hiver. Je voudrais du Fred Astaire. Revoir un latte.
Fenton, I want to start with this point you make about pity. Surely this is the first time you could find people in Ireland feeling pity for the United States.
Yeah, you know, as you say, I'm in Dublin, and there's probably no country in the world that has such awe for America, such love for America, such affection. And I do think people are genuinely feeling pity. You know, people know that most Americans didn't vote for Donald Trump, don't support Donald Trump. And we're all suffering in this crisis, but we're able to imagine what it must feel like to be locked down in a room with a malignant narcissist as your leader. You know, we've seen before in human history, we've seen bad leadership, we've seen a vacuum of leadership, but I don't think we've ever seen anything in a crisis like this that approximates a leader who has been actively spreading a deadly virus, which is really what Trump has been doing by his actions, by the way he's been speaking out of both sides of his mouth at the same time, coming up with quack cures, using this as an excuse to make enemies. Not slightest empathy. You know, you look at leaders all over the world, and however bad they are, they at least feel they have to project some kind of good authority and some kind of empathy at this moment of crisis. And in the democratic world, I mean, there are crazy people out there, but in the democratic world, you can only think of Bolsonaro in Brazil and Donald Trump in the great United States of America, who's behaving in this way.
You make a point in your new piece in the New York Review of Books that Trump is struggling with two contradictory impulses, paranoia versus risk. Explain that.
Yeah, you know, it's an interesting question, isn't it? Because you might think, well, actually, Donald Trump could reasonably claim to have been a kind of prophet of what we're supposed to do in the coronavirus crisis. You know, he's a germaphobe. You know, he washes his hands all the time. He has been on a campaign to stop people shaking hands. You know, he hates coughing. He's, you know, he has all these kind of things going for him. And it's an interesting question as to why did he not get out ahead of this and say, look, I've always told you, you know, I was the guy who my instincts were right about all this kind of stuff. And why couldn't he do that? Well, of course, he couldn't do it because he's drawn between, as you say, these two different forces. One is, and this is conservatism, right? This is conservatism has used these two things. It uses paranoia, fear, there's danger out there, you really should be afraid, which you might think might suit Trump in a way in this crisis. But the counterbalancing one, of course, is this valorization of risk. You know, real men take risks, and it's to do with kind of rugged individualism, it's to do with certain kind of notions as to how the capitalist system works, it's to do with a certain kind of masculinity, isn't it? You know, it's all this kind of stuff about you know, it's only people who are afraid of the nanny state, only people who don't really understand freedom are not willing to take risk. So he's got these two things, and you know, he's been pretty good at dealing with them in his own way up to this crisis. But of course, in a crisis like this, what you get then is an appallingly mixed message, where he keeps encouraging the risk, keeps sending out the signals to people that they should revolt against their state governments and the regulations they're putting down on the one side, and on the other side feeling that, you know, well, he's the president after all and he has to tell people that this is very serious. So what you get is frankly frightening gibberish. You know, it's a mix of messages that in this context just isn't entertaining, isn't funny, is actually deadly.
It is Thursday, the 30th of April of 2020, and you are in West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. I am your chef de cuisine, Justice Putnam, and our daily special is Metro Shrimp and Grits Thursdays, a little bit of jambalaya, a little bit of spice in your life. Oh, yeah. Hey, you know that San Francisco was taken to task about, apparently there's a hashtag San Francisco destroys pizza or something like that. Because I guess some gourmet shop made a potato crust pizza, and apparently that's such an outrage. Of course, anybody who would say San Francisco destroys pizza has never been to North Beach Pizza. In North Beach! My God, one of the greatest pizzas in the world, and I've been to Napoli. Oh, yeah. Anyway, they did not destroy pizza. I'll tell you who destroys pizza, at least down here in Southern Oregon, because they don't do this in the state capital, Salem, and the suburb, Kaiser. But down here, every pizza that you get, and I'm not talking just a pizza shop, every single one gives you what they call a white sauce, which turns out to be ranch dressing. And apparently you're supposed to dip your pizza into the white sauce. Well, I should remind folks that the Oregon Constitution initially made Oregon a white-only state, so a white sauce makes perfect sense for the people down here because they want to go back to the old days, back to the old normal. Yeah, Trump was out there saying, I want to go back to the old normal. I don't want to see people sitting 3, 4, 5 seats away from each other at a football game. And we went over 60,000. We're topping 61,000 and continuing people dying. That fills up a football stadium and no one is sitting 3, 4, 5 seats apart in a football stadium of dead people. So he wants to go back to the old normal, which, Irish fellow there from the Irish Times, Ian O'Toole. Yep. He's a virus. He's Typhoid Mary, or I don't know, Typhoid Don. Oh, which reminds me, a woman was arrested for being a Typhoid Mary, going around and giving people coronavirus knowing she had it. Wow. So I got to check that story out. It sort of reminds me of the articles back in the day when people would be arrested for assault, attempted murder, for having sex knowing they had HIV. Which is, you know, I think probably you shouldn't be doing that. And you might well be charged for such a crime. Speaking of crimes, did Donald Trump forget that he fired Michael Flynn? I mean, he fired his ass. And now he wants to give him, I swear to God, he's going to give him the Presidential Medal of Freedom. He's going to come up. That's right. Oh, my God. And you, which beggars the question also with Bill Barr saying that and Trump that sanctuary cities harbor criminals. Well, I think pardoning traitors and war criminals is pretty much protecting war criminals and traitors. So what does that make you, both Barr and Trump? Yeah, so Mike Flynn is getting a makeover, and he wants a new trial because he was forced to lie to the FBI. The FBI somehow had memos. They had strategy sessions and, you know, how to be good cop, bad cop to get Mike Flynn to lie. Well, isn't that what cops try to get you to do? I mean, come on. Have you never been interrogated by a cop? Or let me put it this way. Have you never seen Law and Order? Oh, man. It's like they're trying to throw away how many decades of television programming that have programmed us into understanding what our justice system is all about. Law and order. Cops interrogating someone to get them to lie. Oh, I'm shocked, shocked. If you lie, yeah, you usually get sent up river. Don't lie to the FBI. It's simple. He lied. He admitted it. But somehow there's some great conspiracy. Maybe there's fluoride in the water and the chemtrails made him do it. And people believe that. I see it on these stupid Facebook boards down here in Southern Oregon, or up here in Southern Oregon, depending on your locus of proximity. And they actually believe this stuff. I got anti-vaxxers, whining that, oh, COVID is not real. Yeah, neither are measles. So, we live in perilous times. A third of the judiciary is now packed with right-wing extremists, young right-wing extremists of the most extreme toxic kind because of Mitch McConnell. I'll leave no vacancy unfilled. Especially with an extremist toxic element. A full 30%, which is the exact same number that we've always had of a toxic element in our society, who now seem to be running everything. They used to be, frightened and hiding behind the walls like cockroaches. Turn on the light and they'd scamper away. Now they hulk up. They become Godzilla. I want what I want, and I want it now, and you got it. I want it. Jesus. So, like I said, we live in perilous times. We have a toxic third that seems to be endemic through our whole government and society. We're not going to get rid of them. We never can. We never have been able to, but they've always just been the 30%. It was expected. Now 30% of the judiciary packed. Packed with even more extreme than what the Federalist Society would want. That's how extreme they are. And the Federalist Society was put up in place to do exactly what has happened. Pack the courts with a bunch of, British loyalists from back in the Revolution who didn't really want the United States to have their own autonomous government. That's why they were called loyalists, not patriots. People keep saying we're fighting the Civil War. I think we're still fighting the Revolution. Not that the British are behind this by any means, but no. They're more American than we are, except for their parliament. But who knows? I mean, we're going back to the Articles of Confederation. And you know why we had a constitution written? Because the Articles of Confederation didn't work. All right. When Trump came in, he said he was going to drain the swamp. He was going to deconstruct the administrative state. And now we find out that Flynn has always been a traitor. Trump and his crew did conspire with Russia to take over America. Vlad actually put in a helping hand, not just luck, but actually manipulated probably the actual votes in counties. I bet we're going to find that out someday. That's why they can only work on the margins. They were able to manipulate 70,000 votes. We need to, when we talk about the blue wave, blue tsunami, that means we need to flood it so that they can't manipulate just a margin. Just a margin. That's all they needed. And yeah, Justin Amash, I never trusted that guy. I thought that guy, he was a little too cute when he went against Trump. I mentioned to some friends, sounds like the fix is in, You're going to have one guy as the outsider, right? But he's like a diversion. He's the receiver downfield that you're faking to. Everybody's looking at him. Look, he's wide open. Does a little play action that way. Everybody moves to the open guy, and then you throw the pass down into the flats to Mike Flynn. Okay. we have our work cut out for us, and we have to get a massive get out the vote effort, not to try to appeal to those who would never vote for us. I keep hearing all this stuff, well, I'm never voting for Biden. Well, don't fight for those votes. That's a waste of time. The same ones who said that they won't vote for Biden also said they wouldn't vote for Hillary. And who do they vote for? Trump. They didn't vote for Jill Stein. My God. Wake up. Don't waste efforts on what we can't get. Let's put our efforts, our time, and our money into getting the votes of that real silent majority. Who the Japanese called back in the day a terrible sleeping giant. You awaken that and you stop the Vietnam War. You get equal protection and due process for minorities. Because why? They are American citizens. Well, we could go on, but we better go on with what's on the rest of the menu here in the Bistro Cafe of West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. And yes, the world for the first time pities the United States. And it's going to be a long time before anyone thinks we're great again. Indeed. On the rest of the menu in the Bistro Cafe, with over a million Americans infected and over 60,000 killed by COVID-19, Jared has deemed Trump's response a great success story. So, social distancing guidelines will not be extended. Trump wants to go back to the old normal. Over 70% of federal prison inmates tested have COVID-19, but families don't find out until their loved ones are dead, and sometimes not even then. And Los Angeles is the first major city offering tests for all residents, regardless of symptoms. I think Bill Barr and Trump are going to say, no, we tell you you can't test people because we're done. It's just going to go away. It's going to disappear, and we don't need tests. After the break, we then move to the chef's table, where Bosnia reported its sharpest daily rise in new coronavirus infections this month after easing its lockdowns. Yeah, a little lesson that we should be learning. And Poland's Supreme Court Chief Justice and a top critic of the country's white nationalist government has retired. All that and more on West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. Bon appetit. Bottom of our homepage at netrootsradio.com. To the rightish of the page is our chat room link, monitored by Kelly Lincoln, locked down in Manhattan. Stay safe, Kelly. Don't touch anything. Don't touch anyone. If you then look to the leftish of the page, at the bottom of our homepage at netrootsradio.com from the chat room link, if you look to the leftish of the page, you will find our Patreon link. And if you could become a recurring Patreon of Netroots Radio, as a few people have, you help us pay our bills. And of course, there's always software and newish machinery to acquire, and that usually costs money. And the generosity of those Patreons have allowed us to do that. And if you would like to become a Patreon, maybe if you could afford a espresso-type coffee drink once a month sent our way, we are able to stretch those funds because we are masters at it, masters of the universe, in stretching funds on the quantum level. Yeah, we leave no quark unstretched. And we have quite a bit of experience at it because we've been doing resistance radio broadcasting 24/7, 365 for going on 10 years. And why do we do it? Well, we have a civic duty, don't we? The founders originally intended for, you know, the Fifth Estate, us, the media, the press, to hold them to account. And we do. And we are able to do that because of your generosity. And apparently your fulfilling of a civic duty to make sure that we indeed have equal protection, due process for all. Maybe life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness rather than life, liberty, and the pursuit to infect as many other people as possible because they're Democrats and maybe even brown or black people. Let them die. Let them die. I'm just thinking of Ben Shapiro. I mean, these guys are out there talking about angel babies, right? It's not a clump of cells. It's life. We got to kill the mother to make sure those clump of cells live. So when they call themselves, you know, like pro-life, oh, yeah, kill them. Ah. Let the clump of cells live. Now they're talking about, hey, when an 80-year-old grandma dies, that's a lot different than when a strapping 30-year-old in the height of their sexual prime passes. Wow, Shapiro, I had no idea. No, I actually had exactly this idea, because whatever they're saying, they're projecting. All right, let's be clear. If you would like to follow Netroots Radio on Twitter, that is so simple, because all you have to do is go to @NetrootsRadio. Tom takes care of that. And both Tom and Kelly do much more than just what they do that I mentioned here. And we thank them tremendously, both of them. If you would like to follow me on Twitter, do so @JusticePutnam. And I post the show notes and links diary on Daily Kos about 10 minutes before showtime, and then post all that up on social media. Isn't that funny? Follow the show on Twitter @CookbookWest. And most importantly, pick up podcasts by way of Spreaker, Stitcher, TuneIn, iHeart, YouTube, iTunes, etc., etc., etc. You know, years ago, someone, you know, I did the spiel, and someone went to etcetera.com, and they said, I can't find your show at etcetera.com. I know. Isn't that weird? I should have said ampersand.com. Okay. Let's look into this first offering here in the Bistro Cafe at West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy, Metro Shrimp and Grits Thursdays. And it comes out of the Associated Press by Kevin Fracking and Jill Colvin. Donald Trump said the federal government will not be extending its coronavirus social distancing guidelines once they expire today, Thursday, and his son-in-law and advisor Jared Kushner predicted that by July, the country will be really rocking again. Yeah, with a spike in coronavirus, you little schmuck. To underscore his confidence, this guy's got nothing but confidence because he's got nothing else. There's no substance there. Make up a happy face on everything. Trump said he plans to resume out-of-state travel after spending more than a month mostly cooped up in the White House, starting with a trip to Arizona next week. Oh, the wide open spaces, you think, eh? And he said he's hoping to hold mass campaign rallies in the coming months with thousands of supporters, even though medical experts have said there is little hope of having a vaccine by then. Putting a positive face on the latest grim numbers, the U.S. death toll has now surpassed American lives lost in the Vietnam War. Trump delivered his daily upbeat update, and Kushner described the administration's much-criticized response to the pandemic as a great success story, because they're well on their way to the 6 million they're hoping will be the final solution. They keep raising the goalposts. I mean, first it was like, no one's going to die. And then it's like, oh, 60,000. Well, you know, if we hold it at 60,000, you know, that 70,000, everybody said, we're good. And then when it gets to 1 million dead, they'll call it a great success because in their minds they're going, man, this is happening fast. 6 million. Even the Nazis weren't able to kill that many people that fast. Wow. This came from heaven on high just for us. Trump also talked up the good news the day provided, hopeful results for a possible COVID-19 treatment, but the government announced dismal new economic numbers as the pandemic took hold and shut down much of the economy, well, you know, there's over 30 million people that we know of that have filed for unemployment benefits, because there's a lot of people that have filed, but they can't get their papers in because no one will take them. The White House has been trying to pivot to a new stage of the crisis, focused on efforts to reopen the nation's economy state by state, amid concerns that lifting restrictions too quickly and without sufficient testing and contact tracing will spur a resurgence. Will? Yes, it will. We're heartened that the worst of the pain and suffering is going to be behind us, Trump said as he led a roundtable with executives from companies like Hilton and Toyota. Trump laid out a vision of a return to pre-coronavirus normalcy, with or without a vaccine, with packed restaurants and filled stadiums. That vision flies in the face of sober assessments from doctors who say the country will need to embrace a new normal. That includes extended social distancing and mask wearing. But Trump then said, argumentatively, by the way, I don't want people to get used to this. I see the new normal being what it was 3 months ago. Oh, wow. When people were dying and you were saying, no, it wouldn't be dying. It's all just going away like a miracle. White House spokesman Judd Deere tweeted that Trump would visit a Honeywell facility in Phoenix next Tuesday, or this coming Tuesday, to highlight production of critical medical equipment production and the addition of 500 manufacturing jobs in the state. Trump also said he was considering making a trip to Ohio, even as much of the country remains under effective lockdown, with all but essential travel banned. Well, as Mike Pence showed when he went to the Mayo Clinic, following coronavirus protocols set forth by the CDC are for little people. Michael Balsamo of the Associated Press brings us this next offering here in the Bistro Cafe of West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy Metro Shrimp and Grits Thursdays. Michael Fleming never got to say goodbye to his father. He did not know his dad was fading away on a ventilator, diagnosed with coronavirus at the federal prison where he was serving time for a drug charge. His father, also named Michael, was held at FCI Terminal Island in Los Angeles and died April 19. At least half the population there is tested positive, the largest known hotspot in the federal prison system. But the first word the family received of the father's illness was the day he died, when a prison chaplain called asking if the body should be cremated and where the ashes should be sent. They just left us all in the dark, Fleming said in an interview with the AP. We had to find out from the news what the actual cause of death was. It was kind of screwed up. The response from the Federal Bureau of Prisons to the growing coronavirus crisis in prisons has raised alarm among advocates and lawmakers about whether the agency is doing enough to ensure the safety of nearly 150,000 inmates serving time in federal facilities. And even though officials have stressed infection and death rates inside prisons are lower compared with outside, new figures provided by the Bureau of Prisons show that out of 2,700 tests system-wide, nearly 2,000 have come back positive, strongly suggesting there are far more COVID-19 cases left uncovered, meaning they're covering it up. Sort of like what DeSantis is doing in Florida, telling morgues telling funeral homes, you don't file those death reports on the cause of death. Now, the 59-year-old Fleming had been serving a 20-year sentence on a drug conspiracy charge. The Bureau of Prisons never notified Fleming's family that he was taken to a hospital or when his condition declined. Not having the opportunity to say goodbye, that would have been invaluable, the younger Fleming said. We will never have that chance. Under Bureau of Prisons policy, the agency is supposed to promptly notify the family of inmates who have serious illnesses, but the agency, which confirmed the family wasn't initially notified, has, quote, discretion when making notifications. Well, they aren't the Humane Society now, are they? At the Associated Press, bring us this final offering here in the Bistro Cafe of West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. The city of Los Angeles will offer free coronavirus testing to all residents, regardless of whether they have symptoms, Mayor Eric Garcetti announced yesterday, Wednesday. Testing centers have been set up across the city, but until now, they were reserved for those with symptoms and frontline employees like healthcare and grocery store workers. Los Angeles will be the first major U.S. city to offer large, wide-scale testing to all its residents with or without symptoms, Garcetti said at his daily briefing. People can sign up online for appointments starting immediately. Priority will be given to people with symptoms such as fever, cough, and shortness of breath, the mayor said. Los Angeles City and County were slow to set up widespread testing, but in recent weeks have expanded the number of test sites. And as of yesterday, Wednesday, there were 34 sites across the county. Garcetti said he's confident the city will have the capacity to test everyone. This is a smart thing to do, he said. It's smart to make sure that you are clear. Residents who feel healthy have been staying at home and haven't been in contact with infected people may decide against getting testing, he said. People will be able to go to back for tests several times without limit. About half of California's total coronavirus cases are in the Los Angeles area. LA County reported 1,541 new COVID cases yesterday, Wednesday, raising the total to almost 24,000 people. Public Health Director Barbara Ferrer said the large number is primarily due to increased testing, in part at institutional settings and some lag in reporting from last week. Well, wait until Trump finds out they're testing in L.A. He doesn't want tests. He doesn't want people to know. But we do already, don't we? All right, let's get to our break. And when we get back from that break, we will go through weather from around the world. And we will finish up with the stories that we have curated for you today. You are listening to West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. And we will be right back.
You are listening to NetRootsRadio.com.
Please hang up and try again.
From a point at sea to the circles of your mind, a new force is at work for planetary transformation. New radio for a new earth.
This is Take Two Movie Review. I'm Mike Friend. This week, It Only Looks Like Eden. The English language debut from Polish director Małgorzata Szumowska is an entry into the burgeoning category of psychological horror. Add to the recent Midsummer and Gretel and Hansel, we now have The Other Lamb, an allegorical tale of religious oppression and its fellow traveler male domination. As the movie begins, we meet a strange religious cult led by the Shepherd, perfectly cast in the person of Game of Thrones' Mikael Houseman. He's a self-styled messiah with the look of a dime store Jesus portrait. His flock is curiously composed of only females who are divided between wives and sisters, distinguished by their color-coded garments. The wives wear red and the sisters blue, but it becomes clear that this distinction isn't sufficient to channel the shepherd's interests. Among the sisters, his favorite is young Sella, played by Raffi Cassidy from Vox Lux. She's just coming of age and has known no other life, but becomes our heroine here as the flock is forced to move from their existing compound to a new home deeper in the woods. It's her intuition, her interactions with an estranged wife, and her hallucinatory visions filled with menstrual imagery and snapshots of an alternate life that show her the way out and bring us to a conclusion foreshadowed in an early scene of a mauled lamb. Szumowska and cinematographer Michael Englert capture a look which is intimate, stark, and sumptuously dark, with lots of through shots and use of depth of field, a face through burning candles, a landscape through wet branches. While gorgeous and disturbing at a lean 97 minutes, The Other Lamb wouldn't have suffered from more attention to the inner workings of the cult or more scenes exploring Sella's betrayal. Still, it's a stunning achievement in creepy. This has been Take Two Movie Review. I'm Mike Friend. Catch up with us at take2moviereview.com and feed us back on our channel on YouTube.
Hi, I'm Scientific American Assistant News Editor Sarah Lewin Fraser, and here's a short piece from the April 2020 issue of the magazine in the section called Advances, Dispatches from the Frontiers of Science, Technology, and Medicine. The article is titled Quick Hits, and it's a rundown of some non-coronavirus stories from around the globe. From Bolivia, a new study traces how smoke plumes from heavy Amazon burning in 2007 and 2010 deposited black carbon and dust in the Andes, speeding up melting of the Zango Glacier by boosting heat absorption. From Italy, new analysis suggests a fragment of ancient glass may have formed from a Herculaneum inhabitant's brain, heated by the AD 79 eruption of Mount Vesuvius. From Cameroon, bones of children buried in the grasslands 3,000 and 8,000 years ago provided the first ancient human DNA from the region. The discovery illuminates early genetic diversity and at least one long-gone population. From Finland, aurora chasers helped to identify a new feature in the Northern Lights. Nicknamed the Dunes, it may reflect an elusive type of ripple in Earth's upper atmosphere. From Japan, researchers isolated and grew an intriguing single-celled microorganism in the lab, found in sediment off the Central Islands coast. The tentacled archaean uses proteins common to multicellular organisms and might lend insight into how the latter evolved. From New Guinea, off the island in northern Australia, researchers spotted four species of intricately patterned sharks that walk on their fins to hunt during low tides. They average less than a meter long and bring the total of known walking sharks to nine. I'm Sarah Lewin Fraser.
Hi, it's Tom. Could we humbly suggest your donation to netrootsradio.com? All we've got to run this 24-hour powerhouse of progressive resistance radio is what comes out of our own wallets. And you. You are our biggest donor. And it doesn't take much. $3, $5. Just go to the bottom of our netrootsradio.com page and hit our secure donate button. Heck, you can even make a recurring contribution. And you'll get a wondiferous pair of Netroots radio stickers for application to your backpack, your bumper sticker, or your banjo. Well, it's up to you which backpack you want to put it on. So donate what you'd like at the bottom of our NetrootsRadio.com's homepage. Because you are our biggest donor. NetrootsRadio.com. Together, we are Resistance Radio.
In 1966, When a young black man in Louisiana was charged with criminal battery for preventing a fight between black and white kids at a newly integrated school, he asked for a trial by jury, to which the state court judge said, "No, you have no right to that." I'm Bill Newman, and this is the Civil Liberties Minute. So a state court judge, acting as judge and jury, found Gary Duncan guilty and sentenced him to prison. Fortunately, Duncan had a tenacious lawyer, Richard Sobel, who at age 29 took his case all the way to the United States Supreme Court and won. Duncan versus Louisiana is the reason people charged with crimes in state court have a federal constitutional right to a jury trial. While representing Mr. Duncan, Sobel himself was charged with a bogus crime and thrown into jail. The message to civil rights attorneys from state authorities being, "Get out or we'll get you as well as your clients." But Sobel never got out and never gave up, and for the next half century fought for criminal justice and for racial and gender equality. The recent New York Times obituary quoted attorney Sobel's former client Gary Duncan as saying this: "They put attorney Sobel in jail and threatened him with his life, but that didn't stop him, and he always had time for me." Richard Sobel died on March 24th. He was 82. The Civil Liberties Minute is made possible by the ACLU, because freedom can't protect itself.
I'm Rick Smith, and this is Labor History in Two. On this day in labor history, the year was 2012. That was the day that updated National Labor Relations Board rules regarding the formation of new unions went into effect. The rules cut down on the time between when workers announce that they want to hold an election to form a union and when that election can actually take place. The rule change was aimed at cutting down delay tactics used by employers to stop unionization. For example, one tactic used by employers was to engage in a long, drawn-out legal battle over which employees could belong to a new proposed bargaining unit. The NLRB's decision helped to curb some of the worst abuses of such tactics. Rich Trumka, president of the AFL-CIO, called the new rules, quote, "a modest but important step to ensure that workers who want to vote to form a union at their workplace get a fair opportunity to do so." Businesses and their allies in Congress, on the other hand, tried everything they could to fight the decision. The U.S. House of Representatives put forward bills that would make union elections much more difficult and attempted to gut the NLRB's funding. The bills did not make it through the Senate, but later that year, the opponents to the changes were able to get the new rules thrown out, claiming the vote at the NLRB did not follow proper procedures. Finally, in December 2014, the rule changes went into effect. The ability to hold a vote on whether to form a union is a core right for workers who want to improve their working conditions, their wages, and workplace safety. Throughout U.S. labor history, business interests have done everything they can to thwart the will of their workers to join together, and delaying union elections is but one of their tactics. For more information, go to laborhistoryin2.com, like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter at laborhistoryin2.
It's time for Nicole Sandler's What's News from NicoleSandler.com and the Progressive Voices Network.
Tell me something good.
Good news blowing in your window.
It should be good.
Good news is knocking on your door.
Good, 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 good.
Good news, good news, good news.
We begin today with some encouraging news.
The data shows that remdesivir has a clear-cut, significant, positive effect in diminishing the time to recovery. The FDA, literally as we speak, is working with Gilead to figure out mechanisms to make this easily available to those who need it.
That's Dr. Anthony Fauci, the director of the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases. A federal trial found that the Gilead Sciences antiviral drug remdesivir can speed the recovery of COVID-19 patients, and the Food and Drug Administration reportedly plans to issue an emergency approval to start using it. The study found at least 50% of patients treated with remdesivir improved. Well, we've reached the end of April, and the 30-day federal stay-at-home period. Donald Trump says he will not be extending the federal government's social distancing guidelines once they expire Thursday. But there's a grim count to think about. The reported U.S. death toll has now edged past Trump's initial 60,000 prediction of what the final American death tally would be. That toll has now surpassed American lives lost in the Vietnam War. More than half of U.S. states will begin reopening by the end of the week, and Trump says federal distancing guidelines will begin fading out as restrictions are lifted. But that doesn't mean life is going to immediately return to normal. And California Governor Gavin Newsom is actually planning to strengthen restrictions by ordering the closure of all state beaches and parks. This after photos of crowded beaches surfaced last weekend. Well, Thursday morning brought the newest unemployment numbers. Another 3.8 million Americans filed for jobless benefits last week, bringing the total number of claims to roughly 30 million in just 6 weeks. This following Wednesday's news that the U.S. economy contracted at an annual rate of 4.8% in the first quarter as businesses lost customers or shut down entirely because of the pandemic. It was the first quarterly drop in 6 years and certainly the steepest since the Great Recession. But it is worth noting that the first quarter included 2 months before widespread shutdowns. But the second quarter won't, so it's expected to be much worse. Some experts warning the economy could contract at a rate of up to 40% in the second three-month period of 2020. Larry Kudlow is Donald Trump's director of the U.S. National Economic Council. And on Wednesday, he agreed with that assessment.
I think the economy is going to suffer through very bad numbers. It's going to sink further. The contraction in the second quarter, it's going to be much deeper than the first quarter. The unemployment rate's going to go up quite a bit.
But don't give him too much credit. Here's what Trump's main economic advisor said just 2 months ago.
The coronavirus is essentially a China problem. And we're doing everything we can to help them, by the way, offering advice, sending smart people over there and so forth. It's not a U.S. problem. The impact on the American economy will be very, very, very small, if any. I mean, actually, you've had 2 months of the virus, Bill, December, January. The January number, yes, that's correct. But I'm just saying what we know factually. The January numbers have come in great, not just jobs, but ISM manufacturing and services, low unemployment claims, strong housing. We really haven't seen any economic impact. There may be some out there. Our own internal numbers say maybe 0.2% in the first quarter. But that's not going to end this growth cycle. If anything, I will give President Trump some credit here, please. His strong State of the Union message, his confidence, his optimism, and tax cuts and deregulation and energy and good trade deals. He has reinvigorated and restructured and rebuilt this economy. It's almost like we're starting a new recovery cycle. And that's why I think it's going to go on for several years.
Several years.
Yes,
would
sir.
Oops. The White House has ordered intelligence agencies to review communications intercepts, satellite imagery, and other data sources to determine whether China and the World Health Organization hid early information on the coronavirus outbreak first detected in Wuhan, China. The tasking was sent to the National Security Agency and the Defense Intelligence Agency last week. The CIA has reportedly received similar orders. Trump said Wednesday he was, quote, getting pieces already, and we're not happy about it. And we are by far the largest contributor to WHO, World Health, and they misled us. Right now, they're literally a pipe organ for China. Beijing has called the cover-up allegations, quote, barefaced lies. So we still have an election coming up November 3rd, and both the Trump and Biden campaigns are feeling the pressure. CNN reported that Trump fumed about his sliding poll numbers and blew up at his campaign director, Brad Parscale, even threatened to sue him. But the Biden camp is having its share of troubles, too. A former aide, Tara Reid, has alleged that in 1993, then-Senator Biden sexually assaulted her. This week, two witnesses came forward to say that Reid told them contemporaneously about the incident years ago. Biden's campaign has denied the allegations, but the candidate himself hasn't said anything. Thursday's Washington Post has an editorial headlined, Biden himself should address the Tara Reid allegations and release relevant records. I agree. After a total mainstream media blackout on the story for a full month since Katie Halper's podcast interview with Reid, the New York Times published a dismissive story a few days ago. Then Stacey Abrams, who's been lobbying for the vice presidential slot, stuck her foot in it when she said the New York Times investigation cleared Biden.
I believe that women deserve to be heard, and I believe that they need to be listened to. But I also believe that those allegations have to be investigated by credible sources. The New York Times did a deep investigation, and they found that the accusation was not credible. I believe Joe Biden.
To be clear, the New York Times did not do a thorough investigation. And on Wednesday, the paper even issued a statement pointing to talking points circulated by the Biden campaign, claiming the Times investigation found that Tara Reid's allegations, quote, did not happen. Well, the Times said, quote, our investigation made no conclusion either way, and then accused them of inaccurately describing their reporting. This issue will not just go away, nor should it. And that's just a bit of what's news for now. I'm Nicole Sandler. If you appreciate these reports and the Nicole Sandler Show, I hope you'll consider making a contribution. My work is 100% listener supported, and I can't do it without your help. Find out more at NicoleSandler.com. Please click on that donate button.
Thank you for accompanying us here to the chef's table at West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy, Metro Shrimp and Grits Thursdays. We always begin, whether from around the world, along the banks of the Rogue River and the Rogue River Valley of Southern Oregon, on the west coast of the continental United States of America, where it is currently 58 degrees Fahrenheit. Expecting to be a tad cooler than yesterday, maybe only about 72 to 74. Though the projected temperature is supposed to be 70, here at the mothership, we run a little bit different, and I've been following my own little weather station here, which isn't as accurate, but over time, the averages pretty much are correct, so I guess it's accurate. There you go. Anyway, about 74 or so. Winds will be out of the west-northwest at 5 to 10 miles per hour in a couple of hours, and mostly partly cloudy conditions for the day. Looks like a few clouds overnight. Lows in the upper 40s, low 50s. We want it to be warmer now, I guess. Winds will be out of the northwest at 5 to 10 miles per hour and partly cloudy tomorrow. High around 75 with winds out of the southwest at 5 to 10 miles per hour. Coronavirus infections in Jackson County here in southern Oregon stands at 49 confirmed cases with no deceased. The grass pollen here locally, right here at the mothership, is rated very high. And the air quality index in the region is good at 27 parts per million, and the daytime UV index is high at 7. Slather on, please, slather on the sun protection. Barometric pressure is holding steady at 30.12 inches. Visibility is at 8 miles. And relative humidity is at 81%. Weather from around the world is brought to you by people's personal weather stations that they purchased. These people planted these purchased personal weather stations somewhere on their property. And these people positively live around the world. London is 48 degrees with heavy rain. And once again, I should remind people about a very chagrined prime minister about not wanting to open up things too soon because that guy had coronavirus pretty bad. Paris is 54 and mostly cloudy with looks like they're going to clamp down with even stronger restrictions because of coronavirus.
Rome is 68 and partly cloudy with a resurgence in infections because of coronavirus. Kyiv is 64 degrees with a thunderstorm and coronavirus. Kabul is 68 and mostly cloudy with mostly a lot of coronavirus. Hong Kong is 72 and clear, and they are seeing a spike in coronavirus because they won't social distance. They're free to do so, apparently. Tokyo is 64 and clear, and looks like they're going to be increasing restrictions because of coronavirus. Sydney, Australia is 53 and clear, and they're getting a plateau, but a lot of people are still dying at that plateau because of coronavirus. San Francisco, California is 52 and partly cloudy, and it looks like Gavin Newsom is going to close all the beaches and everything because people just went out there on their own, and they still have a lot of coronavirus. And New York is 55 degrees Fahrenheit with a light rain, and they are having a decrease in the amount of deaths because of coronavirus. And that is weather from around the world, brought to you by people's personal weather stations that they purchased. These people planted these purchased personal weather stations somewhere on their property, and these people positively live around the world. Daria Sito-Suchik of Reuters brings us this first amuse-bouche here at the chef's table at West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. Bosnia reported yesterday, Wednesday, its sharpest daily rise in new coronavirus infections this month, after its two autonomous regions had gradually begun to ease lockdowns. There were 93 new infections and two deaths in the previous 24 hours, compared with 20 new infections a day earlier and 49 the day before that. The total number of infected people rose to 1,677 with 65 deaths, while almost 30,000 have been tested. Both Bosnia-Croat Federation and the Serb Republic imposed lockdowns last month after the outbreak of COVID-19. Their measures included barring people aged over 65 and children up to 18 from leaving home at all. The Serb Republic, which started on Monday to let senior citizens leave home for 3 hours each workday and some businesses to reopen, reported 59 new cases. Its officials urge citizens to continue to avoid gatherings and to wear masks at all times. The percentage of positive cases in relation to those tested is revealing a lowering of individual discipline in obeying the prescribed measures, Serb Republic Health Minister Alan Serenek said, adding that 8% of those tested in the past 24 hours were found to be positive, up from 5% previously. The whole community is behaving in a more relaxed manner than before, he said, when we had a different number of cases from now and not so many deaths.
Je te donne seulement l'amour pour la vie entière. La promesse de me trouver à tes genoux. Aussitôt que tu m'appelles, rester toujours fidèle. C'est tout, c'est tout. Je te donne tous mes printemps, mes étés de mer, mes automnes quand les feuilles tombent partout. Si ce n'est pas une bonne affaire, je te donne tous mes hivers.
Anna Wolczak-Semczuk and Joanna Pluchinksa of Reuters brings us this final amuse-bouche here at the chef's table at West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. Poland's Supreme Court justice ended a six-year term today, opening the way for the ruling white nationalists to pick a supporter of their contested judiciary overhaul to replace her. After the Law and Justice Party came to power in 2015, the 67-year-old lawyer emerged as a figurehead for opponents of reforms characterized by the EU as subverting democratic checks and balances. Deputy Justice Minister Sebastian Kaleta, a member of the party, said Gerdsov had overstepped her role with frequent involvement in politics. In other words, she doesn't like white nationalists and Holocaust deniers. Well, that brings us to the end of our broadcast period for the day, but you do know Netroots Radio will broadcast on, and we'll meet up tomorrow for Blue Moon Spirits Fridays. So do stay tuned to Netroots Radio all day and all night for all the breaking news as it breaks. And we'll meet up here tomorrow, right here, in West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. Bon appétit.
Je voudrais du soleil vert, des dentelles et des théières, des photos de bord de mer, d'un mangeadin d'hiver. Je voudrais de la lumière, comme en Nouvelle-Angleterre. Je veux changer d'atmosphère, d'un mangeadin d'hiver. Sous la pluie de novembre, tes mains qui courent, je n'en peux plus de t'attendre. Les années passent, qu'il est loin, là je tombe. Nul ne peut nous entendre. Je voudrais du Fred Astaire, revoir un latte coeur. Je voudrais toujours te plaire dans mon jardin d'hiver. Je veux déjeuner par terre comme au long de golfe clair, t'embrasser les yeux ouverts dans mon jardin d'hiver.
Dans mon jardin d'hiver.